are not always sure, yes.
That's probably why.
That's for all of us. Welcome, it's good to be with you all today, this first Sunday of Advent. I have a few announcements. Well, first I want to welcome our visitors. Today, it's so good to have you. I'm so glad that you're here. A few things. First, if you're visiting for the first time, please sign our guest book so we have a record of your presence here with us today, and it's right there when you're walking out. Also, we have a gift bag for our visitors, so let's make sure we get you one. Ushers, y'all help out too. We're going to make sure y'all get a gift bag. And last, please feel free to join us after the service for coffee and treats after the service. So, welcome, visitors. So glad that you're here. That's the spiel. Okay, other announcements. Today, there are a lot of things going on. Choir is rehearsing, the confirmation class is meeting, and tonight the winter shelter begins with Compassionate Hands at Faith Lutheran. We have a number of volunteers who are coming to do laundry or bring breakfast or stay overnight. But there are still openings. So if that is something you feel like you could help with, washing some blankets and sheets and things like that at Faith Lutheran, or bringing breakfast early in the morning, one Monday morning, the sign-up sheet is on the back wall, and it is also on the e-blast, the email that gets sent out. You'll see the link to that. And if you have any questions about what that means, how to do it, talk to me or talk to Deacon Cindy or talk to Slavin Bradley, who goes to the 8:30 service. Y'all may not see him, but if you do, talk to Slavin. He's good too. So that's tonight. It's very exciting. It's going to go for 3 months. So surely there will be an opening. If you don't see an opening and you want one, just hang out, because it'll show up. All right. Okay. Christmas poinsettias. We typically decorate the altar around Christmas time with poinsettias, and they're usually memorial gifts that are given in honor of someone. So if you would like to donate $25 for a poinsettia to decorate the altar come Christmas time, there's a sign-up sheet on the table in the back where you can send me an email, and $25 you can put in the offertory plate, or go online. Online options will be there for you as well. So that's the Christmas poinsettias. Next Sunday, Angel Tree, we're collecting gift cards for the families of Byers Dowdy Elementary. Instead of the shopping, we normally have a shopping list, but it got really expensive. We decided to kind of redo the whole thing. So this year, gift cards. Just Walmart, $25 gift cards, or denominations of $25. That's what we're going to take up next Sunday. And then we'll distribute them through the guidance counselor's office at Byers Dowdy. Also collecting hats and gloves. We had collected about 20 and already gave them because they needed them. It was really cold last week, and so thank you for your donations. And thank you for the coats. We had 52 coats collected for the homeless. That's a lot for our little church. Good job, everybody. I bet your closet's empty now. Thanks for bringing those. It's wonderful. My goodness. Well, I just want to draw your attention to the announcements in the bulletin. They are there. If you have any questions, is there anything else I'm missing? Well, let us know. Oh, I do want to tell you one thing. So instead of the Gloria today, we're going to sing the Trisagion. Trisagion? You say that three times. Trisagion. Alright. And if you're a music reader, look in your hymnal. Go ahead and open your hymnal, have it open, put a piece of paper in there. It's service music, that's S102. S102. And that will help you if you've never heard this before and you can sing music. So it's, as I say, in your hymnal, S102, to sing the Trisagion, which is an ancient prayer. It goes way back, and this is put to music, and we say it during Advent. Or we are this year. Now, let us quiet our hearts as we prepare to worship the risen Christ. Thank you. perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Reading from the book of Isaiah. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains quake at your presence, as when fire kindles brushwood, and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, so that the nations may tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down. The mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard. No ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry, and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all of our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. You all fade like a leaf. And our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you. For you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. You are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 80. Let us read responsibly by half verse. Hear, O shepherd of Israel, leading Joseph like a flock.
Shine forth the glory of our crown upon the cherubim.
In the presence of Ephraim, Benjamin, and Manasseh. Restore us, O God of hosts.
Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved.
O Lord God of hosts,
how long will you be angered despite the prayers of your people?
You have fed them with the bread of tears.
You have given them bowls of tears to drink.
You have made us the derision of our neighbors.
You lap us to scorn.
Restore us, O God of hosts.
Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved.
Let your hand be upon the man of your right hand.
The Son of Man you have made so strong for yourself.
And so will never turn away from you.
Give us life that we may call upon your name.
Restore us, O Lord God of hosts.
Show the light of your countenance, and we shall be saved.
A reading from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that has been given you in Christ Jesus. For in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind. Just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you were called into the fellowship of the Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and he puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn, or else he may find you sleeping when he comes suddenly. And I say to you, what I say to you, I say to you all, keep awake. The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. Let the children come forward for the children's sermon. What you got there? You're bringing things. You got the animals. That's right. So, he is missing. She says, where's baby Jesus?
And
Mary Joseph. Who else is missing?
The three wise men.
And the shepherds. And the lambs. You got it. You're five men. You got it. That's right. Maybe the star is missing too. Yeah. Yeah, there's a lot of people. What do we have today?
We have
the animals. We have the animals. Well, what do you think? Why is this the way it is?
Because we're going to be talking about the animals today.
Maybe. She knows her creation story. The animals were, that's right, that's true. Yes,
ma'am. After Christmas is your birthday.
After Christmas is your birthday? Is it really? You have a December birthday? It's January? Yeah. Well, one at a time, right? It's hard. Some people get put Christmas ahead of Thanksgiving, and it's just wrong. Yes, we have some. I'm going to give you all a little piece of that. This. What is this? Play-Doh.
And to be
Play-Doh.
More specific, it's orange
Play-Doh. Yeah, I'm trying to take it in under code. Yeah. Push it, make a ball. See if you can make a ball. That's right. You know, it's interesting that you brought up the creation story because what did God make the people out of? He made them out of clay. That's right.
And so, Play-Doh is basically just white.
That's right.
That's color.
Yes, it is. It's clay. Yeah.
You put water on it, it gets squishy.
Yeah, we're not going to put water on it. Okay, so can you guys make me a snake? Alright, you guys are potters right now. Pretend this mini wooden potters. You got your snake? Alright. That's good. These are going to be super long snakes. Okay. Well, while you're working on your snake, I want to remind you, or you probably didn't hear it, but in the Old Testament reading from Isaiah, one of the phrases was that God is the potter and that we are the clay. Which is kind of a great thing because we sometimes feel like we have a hard time making things happen. We're not in control. Do you guys feel like you're in control of your lives all the time?
No.
Do you get to drive yourself to school or go to the store if you want to?
No. Yes.
You do. How old are you?
9, but my parents.
That's true. They will. But as a child, and even as adults, we do not have all the control over ourselves and our lives. None of us really knows what's going to happen tomorrow, right? We think we do. We make plans as though we know, but ultimately we can't tell the future. And we are really out of control. And we are just like big lumps of clay. But you know who does know the future? And that is God. Yes.
Or Jesus.
And he takes care of us. And he helps us. Because he is the potter. And we are the clay. And Jesus. Alright, let me see your snakes. Awesome. You should work on yours. That's very nice. I like it. Oh, you got a tongue. That's a advanced placement of snake here. That's good stuff. Well, I think it's time to make our snakes into a ball again. So you can make it into a ball.
I can shake it.
good to be together today. So much happens on the first Sunday in Epiphany. See, we're confused. What season are we in? Oh, Advent. That's right. We're in Advent. Some things have changed since last week. The color. We're now in purple. That's right. Something you may not know. Episcopalians also like what other color for?
Blue.
Blue. That's right. Sarah blue. But we are purple. Yes. And this is happening across the world. Liturgical churches have all changed. They all changed their colors. And we've moved from ordinary time or the season after Pentecost to Advent, preparing for Christmas. And our hearts are starting to be prepared to receive Him, receive the Lord, who comes on Christmas. So today I want to point out three things about the day and about preparing ourselves for Christmas, for the coming of Jesus. First, we notice the purple. You're already there. You've already noticed the purple. The purple represents what?
Royalty.
Royalty, yeah. What did you think? Oh, yeah. Royalty. Very good. And the reason it does is because in the ancient world, purple was very expensive, and only royalty could afford it. It involved collecting mollusks of a certain type and putting them all together, and there was a processing involved, and it was very expensive to have rich fabrics. And so we deck out our church in purple to point to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords who's on his way. It reminds me of a certain woman in the book of Acts in chapter 16. It's Lydia, who's a businesswoman. I want to read the story to you. A certain woman named Lydia, a worshiper of God, was listening to us. This is Paul and Luke talking. She was from the city of Thyatira and a dealer in purple cloth. The Lord opened her heart to listen eagerly to what was said by Paul. When she and her household were baptized, she urged us, saying, "If you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come and stay at my home." And she prevailed upon us. And then the chapter ends. After leaving the prison, they went to Lydia's home. And when they had seen and encouraged the brothers and sisters there, they departed. Lydia was a dealer in purple. In other words, she was a wealthy woman. She was a businesswoman. Her whole household also was baptized. Without any mention of a husband or a father or a son. So this woman had some prominence, some ability to make decisions for her own household. And she had a large house. She must have been, fairly wealthy, because she invited the entourage of Paul and his group to all stay with her. And then later on, it implies that the brothers and sisters of the church members were meeting at her home. And so she is a founding member of the Church of Philippi, quite a woman of prominence. And the one thing I wanted to point out that's especially important today is that it says that, the Lord opened her heart to listen eagerly to what was said by Paul. The Lord opened her heart to listen. That's a good Advent word, that the Lord would open our hearts to listen. And so that's the first thing, to consider purple and Lydia, and open hearts to the Lord. It's also good to mark the female leaders of the church in the New Testament. They don't get a lot of attention sometimes, so attention, ding. Okay, second, we prepare our hearts for Him by noticing the church year. On your bulletin today, you have an image of the movement of the church year. You'll see Advent is on the left-hand side, next to December, gotten done, but the church in here, we're not there yet. We're waiting. We're anticipating. We're preparing our hearts with expectation. We're going to make him room, right, for the big day on the 25th of December. And then we have 12 days after that to keep celebrating. Most of y'all will probably be full of holiday food, visiting friends. But that's how it works. The 12 days of Christmas begin on the first day of Christmas. The 12 days begin on the first day. That's what I need to say. But the world is outside doing its thing, and we are not there yet. Or the church is not. Now, if y'all want to decorate, please do. Please, I've already put my tree up. Just like, you didn't what? Because most, back in the old days, Episcopalians did not put their Christmas tree up until when?
Christmas Day.
Christmas Eve. The world's a different place now, isn't it? Wow. But the gift of the church is it helps us take it, be a little peculiar, do something a little different. The church is called to be separate. It's called to be holy. It lives set apart from the world in a way. And this is just one way for Christians to be able to do that and be a little weird compared to the world for the Lord. The second gift is that it orients our lives around the life of Christ, around him. He came at Christmas. He rose on Easter. And so we start with Christmas and back up 4 weeks. And then at Easter changes. It's according to the lunar cycle, right? And in the calendar of Passover. So that's what Easter is. So then we mark back your 40 days, 6 Sundays. So we orient our lives around the life of Christ. What better thing to organize our life around but him and his works and what he's done for us? If you like this, I encourage this image. Tear it off, take it home, put it on your refrigerator, you know, to help you be mindful of the seasons of the year. Okay, so we're preparing ourselves by remembering the purple and Lydia, opening our hearts, and by noticing the church calendar. And then third, the last thing, is we prepare our hearts by remembering the why. Why did Jesus have to come? Advent begins in the dark. You heard the reading from the Gospels today. It's all apocalyptic literature. The Lord is going to return, and we have to be awake. We have to be ready. And it's a little bit fearsome, a little bit trembling, you know, like, oh, here he comes. Am I ready? Are we awake? Advent begins in the dark. It begins with blindness. With not being able to see, not knowing what's going to happen in the future. We don't know. We can't predict, but he does. In our Isaiah reading, it says, "Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down." And it's a cry. It's a cry for salvation. Salvation from two things, from suffering. Jewish people have suffered for millennia. Back in Isaiah's day, back through the centuries with pogroms, with World War II, even to this day, the Jewish people are under it's a complicated situation, don't get me wrong, but they're suffering and have suffered. And so Isaiah's words here today echo throughout the millennia. Oh, Lord, would you come down and solve this? Relieve our suffering. Suffering of Israel, and the suffering of us, too. Life is difficult, and we pray for God's mercy and relief. And we also pray for his forgiveness. It goes on to say, "We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth." This is what Isaiah cried out, and so do we during our time of Lent. Lent, excuse me, feels like Lent. That feels like Lent, doesn't it? Advent is kind of a mini Lent. It's hopeful and full of expectation, but it's also a little bit penitent, a little bit, "I'm sorry, Lord, we need you. Our world is dark, we need your light. Come, Lord Jesus." over. The second one is the second coming. And when is the third one? Now. He comes to us now through the Holy Spirit, the grace of the Holy Spirit. Advent is upon us. And the Lord is preparing our hearts. He's opening our hearts to prepare to receive Him. And so, as we are preparing ourselves, let us be mindful of the purple and Lydia and the prayer that God would open our hearts. We remember the church calendar and the new year. And finally, we remember the why. Why did He come? Why did He come? He came to save us. May God, during this Advent season, open our hearts like He did that of Lydia to receive His message and to receive Him. Amen.
Let us pray for those on our prayer list on the back page of the bulletin. For
those in long-term care.
Kathy, Wyoming, Virginia.
For first responders and those in military service and their families, especially.
John, Dalton, Jonathan, Trevor, Mallory.
For those having birthdays this month.
Slaven, Ginger, Morgan, Dell, Mary Lou.
For all those having wedding anniversaries.
Father Dennis, Greg and Christine.
We pray for Byers County Elementary and in our diocese and cycle of prayer, we pray for Church of the Advent, Nashville.
Hasten, O Father, the coming of your kingdom, and grant that we, your servants who now live by faith, may with joy behold your Son at his coming in glorious majesty, even Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
You may be seated. And if there is anyone who has become a member in the last year or so, would like to be recognized with the blessing of the new members, come on up. Y'all come on up, and does everybody, wait a minute now, I forgot to tell you this. Y'all have the blessing of the newcomers as a piece of paper that should have been in your bulletin?
No.
All right, we need those. Those are important. Sorry about this, y'all. Liturgy that comes from the Book of Occasional Services. We occasionally have other services. That's why they call it a Book of Occasional Services. Little miscommunication. All right. Okay. All set. So first of all, I want to welcome you all again. You know. you all have it as well, good. All right, so this is what we'll do. I'm going to come back here so I can see you all. The liturgy's here. There, the important parts that you all say are going to be in bold, as we do. At the very bottom, the congregation, there is a paragraph there that begins with, "You recognize?" That's for y'all, okay? So we need all y'all.
Y'all.
We do so. As do you, right? Yes, okay. All right. So, actually, before we begin, though, I want to introduce everybody, or at least let you introduce yourself. Could we start over there and just say your name?
Morgan.
I'm Carol.
Jean Powell.
Heather.
I'm Seth.
Sarah.
I'm Matt.
Lucy. Okay. Y'all make a point to introduce yourself if you haven't met these folks. Okay, here we go. I welcome new members of the congregation to come forward. Here you are. Do you renew your commitment to Jesus Christ?
I do.
Will you seek to be faithful in the worship of God and participate in the life of this community of faith?
I will, with God's help.
Will you participate in a life of service to those who are poor, outcast, or powerless?
I will, with God's help.
Will you strive to recognize the gifts that God has given you and how they might be used in the binding up of God's realm?
I will, with God's help.
Will you commit time, talent, and money to this congregation and to its ministry in this city and in the world?
I will, with God's help.
Will you support these persons in their new life at Church of the Epiphany?
We will.
Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, our Maker, for you form us in your image and restore us in Jesus Christ. Bless these new members of Church of the Epiphany. Strengthen their union with the whole body of Christ as they join us in our life of praise and service. Through our Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us welcome these new members of this community of faith. We recognize you as members of the household of God and welcome you as members of this congregation. Confess the faith of Christ crucified, proclaim his resurrection, and share with us in his eternal priesthood. Would you all sign the book right here, which says you're signing to be part of our church? This is metaphorical. Y'all have already filled out your membership information. Yeah. Now let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us as an offering and sacrifice to God.
Glory of your name.
calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father,
we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory,
and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where, with all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine